Hello, Discovery Learners. Happy Thursday. Today is the 19th of November, and it's I, your host, once more, Teacher Liz. Got a good show for you today, and also started a new segment. Gonna be recommending some cool TV shows, so be sure to tune in all at the end to hear some recommendations on what you can watch on TV at home. Also lined up some cool landmarks to learn about, and of course, some fun observances to hear. And don't forget, Discovery Learners, to log in every day for your daily Zoom sessions provided to you by the Discovery Educational Team. Now let's not delay any further. Let's go ahead and start the show. And now for our daily observances. Our first observance is National Play Monopoly Day. Oh, sounds fun. I love Monopoly. National Play Monopoly Day on November 19th recognizes the iconic board game that lands us on Park Place, Boardwalk, or even in jail. Known as one of the most popular board games in the world, Monopoly was originally based on a board game designed by Elizabeth Maggie in 1902. Since then, the game has been played by an estimated 500 million people since 1935. Wow, that's a lot of people. The object of the game is to collect as many properties as you can to create a monopoly. When players land on your property, you get to collect rent. The more properties you own, the more money you make. But watch out, there are taxes and other fees involved. To win the game, you need to bankrupt your opponents and be the last landowner standing. Many families have house rules that make the game more interesting too. Monopoly also comes in numerous versions. Do you enjoy a popular book or movie franchise or hobby? The game likely comes in these themes, focusing on famous characters and likely scenarios. How about a favorite sports team or a pop culture icon? Monopoly money goes there too. So how do you observe Play Monopoly Day? Well, put your banker cap on, gather your family or friends together, and play Monopoly. See if you could come out the winner. What are your house rules? How long do games last in your house? Or do they end up in turmoil? So do you plan on playing Monopoly today? Have you played Monopoly? Do you like it? Have you ever won? If so, let me know in the comment section below. Our next observance is the Great American Smokeout. Each year, on the third Thursday in November, the American Cancer Society sponsors the Great American Smokeout. This is an annual social engineering event to encourage Americans to stop smoking tobacco. The Great American Smokeout challenges smokers to quit cigarettes for 24 hours and hopes that this decision will continue forever. There are benefits to one day without cigarettes. After just 20 minutes without a cigarette, the heart rate drops. So does the blood pressure. 12 hours later, the body will cleanse the carbon monoxide from its last cigarette from the body. That's a great start. If you make it past one day, your risk of heart attack begins to decrease along with heart disease and stroke. Just after one day, keep it up. After 2 days, things start tasting and smelling better. That's because your nerves are healing from smoke damage. Day 3 may be tough. The nicotine is leaving your body, and symptoms of withdrawal may occur, but you can do it. By 1 month, you may notice you can breathe better. The coughing is less, your lungs may be clearer. So how do you observe the Great American Smokeout? Well, if you're a smoker, join other millions of smokers and don't smoke for a day. If you don't smoke, support your friends and family who are trying to quit smoking. It may be tough, but stay positive. Keep on going and don't give up. So do you know anyone who smokes, Discovery Learners? Do you know if they want to quit? Well, be sure to let them know about today's observance. Be sure to provide support, not judgment, and let them know you care. Another observance for today is National Rural Health Day. National Rural Health Day focuses on the medical resources rural communities offer and how it impacts the small towns and citizens. The third Thursday in November each year highlights the varied opportunities rural health offers and the benefits it brings to those modest hubs of economic vitality in the heartland. Around the nation, over 60 million Americans live and work in rural communities. In these thriving centers of industry, health clinics and hospitals provide much-needed care to a varied population. Healthcare improves not only the life of one's citizens, but the livelihood too. Increased economic opportunities are just one of the many reasons for maintaining healthcare close to small towns. Emergent care and urgent care increases the timely treatment of critical ailments and injuries. When nursing care is available, grandparents remain near their family settings. Primary care provides a remedy for chronic and routine conditions. Other facilities may be available in some small communities, including dental, chiropractic, and vision care. Altogether, these facilities keep a community running smoothly and healthily. It's something to celebrate. So how do we observe National Rural Health Day? Well, first let me tell you what rural means. It usually means out of the city, in the countryside, on farms. That is called a rural setting. And if that's where you live, this observance is for you. So go ahead, celebrate National Rural Health Day by letting a local healthcare professional know you appreciate their care. And our last observance for today is International Men's Day. International Men's Day, observed on November 19th, focuses on men's health, improving gender relations, highlighting positive male role models, and promoting positive expressions of masculinity. It's also an opportunity to recognize men who don't fall into traditional manifestations of masculinity. So how do we observe International Men's Day? Well, donate to a charity. Most charities help men get educated to the fact that their health matters. Seeking medical care when needed is important. You can also learn more about lesser-known influential men. Consider picking up a book or watching a movie about an exceptional man whose life and work is still making an impact on the world today. Or, better yet, you could check in with the men in your life. Building positive relationships with men is a lofty goal, but has a humble beginning. Check in with your male family members and friends and see how they're doing. If they're happy at home, that's half the battle won. So how do you plan on celebrating International Men's Day? Let me know in the comment section below. On this day in history. Today, in 1805, Lewis and Clark expedition led by Meriwether Lewis and William Clark reaches the Pacific Ocean. President Thomas Jefferson proposed an expedition in 1802 to explore the unknown western lands, following the great rivers across the continent. In November 1805, the Corps of Discovery expedition led by Lewis and Clark reached the Pacific Ocean. Meriwether Lewis and William Clark assembled the expedition and departed from St. Louis with a group of young men with a dog in May of 1804. Along the way, the corps added an essential member, a young Shoshone woman, Sacajawea, with a new baby, who helped guide the expedition. A year and a half later, the Corps Discovery paddled their dugout canoes through the rain and high waves on the Columbia River. Lewis and Clark spent a month exploring the North Washington and South Oregon side of the river, and then built Fort Clatsop for their winter camp. The corps lived there for 4.5 months at Fort Clatsop, preparing for their homeward journey. As the corps hunted for food, they mapped the Columbia River and explored the area, including Cape Disappointment. And on November 19, 1805, Lewis made a solo trip, and then Captain Clark took a group to survey the coast and camped near Mackenzie Head. There, for the first time, the corps saw the immense blue ocean, the Pacific. They were quoted in saying, "We behold with astonishment the waves dashing across the rocks and this immense ocean." When the expedition returned safely in 1806, only one person had died the whole trip. The corps crossed the unexplored wilderness to the Pacific Ocean. They mapped the continent, collected plants, animals, and minerals, wrote detailed information about the customs and languages of Native Americans, survived hardship and life-threatening dangers as well. Their contribution is a lasting one. It was not about conquest, it was a voyage of discovery. Today, in 1863, the 16th U.S. President Abraham Lincoln delivers his famous Gettysburg Address, beginning 67 years ago. The Gettysburg Address is a speech that U.S. President Abraham Lincoln delivered during the American Civil War at the dedication of Soldiers National Cemetery in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. On the afternoon of November 19, 1863, 4.5 months after the Union armies defeated those of the Confederacy at the Battle of Gettysburg. It is one of the best known speeches in American history. Now let's go ahead and hear the speech, told by famous country singer Johnny Cash.
67 years ago, so began the message of a war-weary President Abraham Lincoln. A message written on the back of an envelope on the train on the way to dedicate a battlefield where men from the North and South had died at Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. 67 years ago, our forefathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. For the brave men living and dead who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, and that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
Today in 1939, comic book superheroes The Flash, Jay Garrick, and Hawkman Carter Hall make their first appearance in The Flash Comics No. 1. Published by DC, The Flash, or simply Flash, is the name of several superheroes appearing in the American comic book published by DC Comics. Created by Gardner Fox and artist Harry Lampert, the original Flash appears in The Flash Comics No. 1. Nicknamed the Scarlet Speedster, all incarnations of The Flash possess super speed, which includes the ability to run, move, think extremely fast, and use superhuman reflexes and seemingly violate certain laws of physics. The golden era Flash was Jay Garrick, a college student who gained his speed through inhalation of hard water vapors. When he is reintroduced in the 1960s, Garrick's origins were modified slightly, gaining his powers to exposure to heavy water. Jay Garrick was a popular character in the 40s, being a character member of the Justice Society of America, the first superhero team whose adventures ran in all-star comics. With superheroes' post-war decline in popularity, Flash Comics was canceled, with issue 104 in 1949, which featured an evil version of the Flash called The Rival. The Justice Society's final Golden Age storyline ran in All-Star Comics No. 57. The title itself continued as All-Star Western. Thus far, at least four different characters, each of whom somehow gained the power of super speed from the Speed Force, have assumed the mantle of the Flash in DC history. College athlete Jay Garrick, forensic scientist Barry Allen, Barry's nephew Wally West, and Barry's grandson Bart Allen. Each incarnation of the Flash has been a key member of at least one DC premier teams, the Justice Society of America, the Justice League, and the Teen Titans.
Notable figures born on this day.
Our first notable figure is Calvin Klein.
born November 19, 1942, in New York City, New York. This American fashion designer, most recognized for his revolutionary men's underwear, first appeared on a cover of Vogue in 1969. He attempted to market fragrances and cosmetics in the 1970s, before finding success in his underwear in the 1980s. He's known for his red carpet runway looks and ready-to-wear accessory lines. He turns 78 years old today. Wow! Happy birthday, Calvin! Our next notable figure is Jodie Foster. Born November 19, 1962 in Los Angeles, California. This American actress first gained fame for her role as a teenager in the 1976 Martin Scorsese film Taxi Driver. She won an Academy Award for Best Actress for her performances in The Accused and Silence of the Lambs, and also had starring roles in Contact, Anna and the King, and Panic Room. She turns 58 years old today. Happy birthday, Jodie. Another notable figure for today is Adam Driver. Born November 19, 1983 in San Diego, California. This American actor is best well known for playing Kylo Ren in the most recent Star Wars trilogy. He's also known for playing Adam Sheckler in the hit HBO series Girls. Many don't know, but he's also a Marine who joined the Corps after the tragedy of September 11th. He also created a nonprofit organization called Arts in the Armed Forces that puts on shows for the military. He turns 37 years old today. Happy birthday, Adam! And our last notable figure for today is Meg Ryan. Born November 19, 1961 in Fairfield, Connecticut. This American actress who starred in several romantic comedies including Sleepless in Seattle, and in 1997 she appeared in Addicted to Love, and in 1998 she appeared in You've Got Mail. She's also lent her voice for a starring role in Anastasia. She turns 59 years old today. Wow! Happy birthday, Meg! Come along, Discovery Learners, and we will see the landmarks of the world. As we continue our journey of discovery throughout Lebanon, here are some landmarks you should see. Starting with the Muhammad Al-Amin Mosque, also referred to as the Blue Mosque. This marvel is located in downtown Beirut. It was built after the donation of the late Prime Minister Rafik Hariri, and continues to be a symbol of his work. The mosque is only one of the achievements of the late Prime Minister. He shifted his business focus to rebuild downtown Beirut to what it is today, provided students with educational scholarships, and encouraged foreign investment in Lebanon. Pretty cool. Next up is the natural landmark, Pigeon Rocks. Located in the sea by the historical Rayush, in the area surrounding the rocks, evidence of ancient human existence in Lebanon has been found. The Pigeon Rocks is an incredible natural formation in the Mediterranean Ocean. The rocks jut out of the sea and arch together, making for a spectacular sight. They are best viewed at sunset or sunrise, which are also the best times for taking photographs. While they can be viewed from a pathway leading to the sea city, there is also opportunities to take a boat to get a real close look at these natural wonders. Next up is Martyrs Square in Beirut, an important landmark in Lebanese history. Martyrs Square is dedicated to those who were executed during the Ottoman rule. It is also the traditional dividing line between East and West Beirut. First constructed in 1931, the monument has remained relevant till this day. And lastly, the ruins of Baalbek. The ruins in the historically significant town of Baalbek are impressive remains of the Roman era. Significantly scaled up, but intricately detailed, these memories are a wonder of the ancient world. The most popular archaeological sites are the well-preserved temples of Jupiter, Venus, and Bacchus, where people used to go to pray to ancient Roman gods. Pretty interesting. Lebanon is an old country with lots to see, but not enough time to cover it all. But what we did see was pretty amazing. Isn't Lebanon great?
Here's the animal of the day.
Today's animal is sheep. You know what sound the sheep makes? Bah! Pretty good, huh? Maybe you should try doing it. Sheep are related to antelopes, cattle, musk oxen, and goats. All these mammals are even-toed ungulates. Their hooves are cloven, or split into two toes. They're also ruminants, which means their stomachs have multiple chambers to aid in digestion. Most sheep have large, curling horns that are made of keratin, the same stuff as fingernails. Most people are familiar with sheep as woolly farm animals that say baa. But the domestic sheep is just one species of sheep. There are also 5 or 6, depending on the source, species of wild sheep. It is estimated that there are more than 10,000 distinct breeds of domestic sheep worldwide. Wow, 10,000. And they're all very diverse in size. Selective breeding throughout the years has produced sheep with or without horns, wool, and external ears. They can range from 4 to 6 feet and from 2 to 4 feet at the shoulder. Sheep were among the first animals to be domesticated, and they were raised all over the world. Wild sheep also live throughout the world, in the Middle East, Asia, Central Europe, and North America, mostly in mountainous areas. Bighorn sheep live only in the Rocky Mountain region of North America. Desert bighorn sheep live in Death Valley, California, as well as Nevada, Texas, and northern Mexico as well. They can live on the desert mountains as high as 4,000 feet up. Some sheep are found in Asia and the Middle East on grassy terrains with elevations up to 19,690 feet up. Wow, that's high. Sheep are social animals, but usually with only their own gender. Males have their own herds called bachelor herds. These herds usually contain about 5 to 50 rams at one time. The females live in a nursery herd. Nursery herds can have up to 5 to 100 members that include adult females and their babies. Male sheep usually fight for dominance in their group. Some ram each other at speeds of 20 miles per hour. Wow, that's fast. Imagine getting bonked in the head at 20 miles per hour. Dominance is gained when one male submits, and this process can take hours. Sheep are herbivores, which means they eat plants. They typically eat seeds, grass, and other plants. Like all ruminants, they have multi-chambered stomachs that are adapted to ferment cellulose before digestion. To completely digest their food, sheep will regurgitate their food into their mouths, re-chew it, and then re-swallow it. Gross! This regurgitated food is called cud. Some sheep don't need much water. The desert bighorn sheep, for example, gets most of its water from eating plants. Female sheep are usually pregnant for 5 months and give birth in the spring. Baby sheep are called lambs. Lambs can walk just minutes after born, though they're often dependent on their mothers for the 4 to 6 months of their lives. They're weaned around 4 to 6 months, and they become mature around 1 to 5 years, depending on the species. Fun things to know about sheep is, wool comes from sheep, and is usually turned into clothing. Humans also eat sheep. Ever heard of lamb chops? And speaking of lamb chops, you remember that puppet, Lamb Chop? She was super cute. Sheep is pretty cool, and their babies are so adorable. What do you think of the sheep, Discovery Learners? Let me know in the comment section below.
The plant of the day.
Today's plant is green beans. Green beans are one of America's most popular vegetables. Like peas, they're harvested while they're young and eaten with the shell. Did you know that if you don't pick green beans when they're young, the pods will harden? The beans inside can be dried and used for making soups like chili. Green beans can grow in two ways, on bushes or on plants with long vines. The bush plants produce a lot of beans all at once. The vine plants, called pole beans, produce beans throughout the growing season. Bean plants have pretty white flowers and deep green tear-shaped leaves. The leaves feel a bit fuzzy and can make you itch if they touch your skin. There are at least 130 different kinds of beans. Most are green, but some are purple, yellow, or even spotted. Green beans are healthy. They're a good source of vitamin A, vitamin C, and folate. I love green beans. I like eating them with white rice. But here are some facts about green beans you should know. Raw green beans are actually a little bit toxic. You're not gonna die or anything from eating them, but if you eat them fresh from the garden, you're eating a tiny bit of poison. The toxins are more concentrated in the seeds than in the pot. So if you're going to eat them raw, choose young pods that have small seeds. Never fear though, because cooking them will break down the toxins and make the beans safe to eat. The average production of snap green beans in the US each year is almost 800,000 tons. Wow. With Wisconsin growing almost 300,000 tons alone. That's a lot of green beans. So much for being the cheese state, huh? Green beans are the third most popular vegetable grown in backyard gardens, after tomatoes and peppers. It's possibly because they're pretty dang easy to grow in the right conditions. Green beans are sometimes called string beans because of when people first grew them years ago, they had fibrous string that ran along inside the seam of the bean. The string was noticeable when you snapped off the ends. That snapping noise is the reason for its most common nickname, the snap green bean. Also, green beans grow super fast. The length of time from planting to harvesting is as short as 45 days when it's warm. They hate the cold and they won't grow in it. The use of beans has been so integrated in our culture that there are even a few expressions in English that incorporate them, like spill the beans, skinny as a string bean, and full of beans, just to name a few. So what do you think of the green bean discovery, learners? Do you like them? Do you eat them often? Let me know in the comment section below.
And now for the word of the day. Today's word is monopoly. It's a noun. It means the exclusive possession or control of the supply of or trade in a commodity or service. Monopoly. Our next word is domesticated. It's an adjective. It means of an animal tame and kept as a pet or on a farm. Domesticated. Let's take a look at the art of the day. Today's art is the Bietedin Palace. Yes, the entire palace. When first laying eyes on the Bietedin Palace, it's easy to see why it's seen as one of Lebanon's greatest cultural treasures, with its elaborate architecture, historic mosaics, and priceless decorations. However, all this beauty and art was created at a high human cost. Building it took over 30 years, beginning in 1788. The palace was the personal home of Emir Bashir Hashab II, who wanted the mansion to be a place of singular beauty and legendary opulence. The castle was built on a hermitage called Benedictine, meaning House of Faith, and featured all manner of amenity including a lush personal apartment for the emir, a harem, a rich guest house that was often offered to passing luminaries and dignitaries. Many of the surfaces were inlaid with intricate mosaics and designs, many of which have survived remarkably well to this day. Unfortunately, all of this grandeur is said to have come at a great price. It has been said that the emir ordered the architect of the palace have his hands cut off so that the Bietedin Palace could not be duplicated. In addition, he is said to have conscripted all of his healthy male subjects to work on the project for days at a time with no pay. Despite the possible labor tragedies associated with it, the palace was eventually taken over by the Ottomans and was used as a government building before eventually being turned into a protected historical site. Today, the palace still remains in its stunning architecture and handmade mosaics and is still an important site for both visitors and the people of Lebanon. Wow, this palace is beautiful, and the art inside it, spectacular. What do you think of the Bietedin Palace, discovery learners? Let me know on the comment section below.
Hey, Discovery Learners! Today is Thursday, and here's some TV to tune into. This week's recommendation is the classic TV show Doctor Who. It's a sci-fi adventure comedy that follows the adventures of the Doctor as he flies through space and time with his companions in his blue telephone box called the TARDIS. He gets to meet and help amazing historical figures from Winston Churchill to Vincent Van Gogh. And because the show has been around since the 60s, there have been a number of actors who have gotten the chance to portray the Doctor. So if you become a fan of the show, you can also have a favorite Doctor. Mine's the 11th Doctor. Give the show a go and let us know who your favorite Doctor is down in the comments section below. The show's rated TVPG and has an average runtime of 45 minutes, and you can be found on HBO Max. Alon Z, Discovery Learners.
Here is today's interesting fact. Did you know that the Three Musketeers candy bar originally had three flavors? It's true. The Three Musketeers candy bar is made in the United States and Canada by Mars Incorporated. It's a candy bar consisted of chocolate-covered fluffy whipped mousse. It is virtually identical to the globally known Milky Way bar, and the only difference being the Milky Way bar has a caramel topping. The Three Musketeers bar was the third brand produced and manufactured by M&M/Mars, introduced in 1932. Originally, it had three pieces in one package, each flavored chocolate, strawberry, and vanilla, hence the name, Three Musketeers, which was derived from the novel Three Musketeers by Alexander Dumas. So why don't they have three flavors anymore? Well, that's because of rising costs and wartime restrictions on sugar saw the phasing out of vanilla and strawberry pieces to leave only the popular chocolate mousse. It cost 5 cents when it was first introduced, and it was marketed as the largest chocolate bars available, and one bar could be shared amongst friends. So yeah, that sweet, chocolatey, fluffy Three Musketeers bar originally came in three flavors. Pretty interesting, huh? Aw, we all know what that song means. It means we reached the end of today's episode of Ability to Learn. I had fun, and I hope you had fun too. But not only had fun, I hope you learned something as well.
Don't forget to hit like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon so you're notified for all the fun here on Ability to Learn.
This is Teacher Liz signing out. Farewell, Discovery Learners. I will see you next time.
Don't forget to attend the live Zoom sessions provided to you every day by the Discovery Day Program's educational team.